Okay, so I asked the organizer, are you sure it's a risk and stochastics with an A, or is it or stochastics, or is it both? They told me this was fine, so it's their fault. Huh? Okay, but seriously, thank you very much for the invitation. So this is joint work with John Armstrong at King's College London. It's a new way to look at basically Ito calculus and geometry, okay? Usually Ito calculus and geometry, there's some works like the Ito bundle and so on, but there's not they're not much used usually. This has had some applications in finance as well, especially on consistency of interest rate dynamics and shapes of the yield curve. Thomas Bjork's historical work, he used Stratonovich calculus there. So I'm going to discuss these two different stochastic calculi, Ito and Stratonovich, and, you know, give some new insight on how to interpret an Ito SD geometrically. This is a new idea. So I would like to dedicate, first of all, the talk to Giovanni Battista Di Masi, who passed away recently on April 4. He was a professor in the University of Padua and head of the Department of Mathematics. He had a PhD at Brown University. And was a well-known author in stochastic analysis, filtering and control. He was also involved in the local administration in Padua as an assessor, and in particular, he was my dissertation supervisor in Padua, and he was also at my PhD Viva. So I would really like to dedicate this talk to him. Okay? So let's get started then. The subject are stochastic differential equations. So this is a very simple one, an autonomous SDE, where we have a drift, A of xt, and a diffusion coefficient, B dw. So in finance, typically this is a volatility term. This is a random input for the system. And this is a drift, the local trend of the signal, as asset price and interest rate and whatever. And the problem with this equation when you try to interpret it initially, and a lot of you will know this already, I'm repeating for the few who may not be familiar with the topic, this is a signal that models some random noise. The derivative of Brownian motion does not exist, but would be white noise in some advanced mathematical sense. This is a model that keeps pumping randomness into the system. And the problem is that this process that models randomness as rough paths. The paths have unbounded variation, and they are nowhere differentiable with probability one. So this is not really a differential, even if we wrote it like this, and this is not a real differential equation on the paths. So to interpret it, typically what you do, you write it, use a fundamental theorem of calculus ansatz, and you write it as an integral equation. And now the problem is defining the second integral. The first one can be defined as a pathwise integral, mean square or whatever. The second one, however, needs to be defined properly because having this process unbounded variation, this is not a classic stiltish integral on the paths, okay? So, again, many of you know this very well. And what you can do is try to define this integral, and there are two possible main definitions for it. One is, and I'm using a Riemann sum type definition because it allows for a more direct comparison here. So one first definition of the stochastic integral in the differential equation is a limit of a sums of the integrand B evaluated at the beginning of each interval in the partition. We are taking a limit for the mesh of the partition going to zero. Initial point on the interval, future increment of the random signal, of the noise, of Brownian motion, okay? This is well known, the limit converges in mean square to the Ito integral. The other one is similar, and it has this circle to distinguish it from the other one. And in this other definition, you take the midpoint rather than the initial point. You take the midpoint of each small partition when you take the limit. The more precise definition would be with the average of the integrand at the two extreme points of the partition, the arithmetic average. But in case of continuous paths, we can use, the both definition and they coincide. So one looks the midpoint of the partition in the limit. The other one takes the initial point. This is said to look into the future, because if this is the future increment starting from now, time ti, this x here is calculated at the future time between now and the future time where you're getting with the increment. So this this definition, the second one, looks into the future. That's a popular expression to say that it's anticipative in a way, okay? So the good things of the first definition with the initial point, the Itô integral, are that it does not look into the future, which is a good thing for social sciences. You often don't want to integrate things that look into the future. Processes are typically adapted or even predictable. It is a martingale, so this has many important consequences in stochastic calculus and in applications as well. In particular, this allows you to interpret the coefficients of DSD as a local mean and the local variance. Okay, so A, the drift, is a local mean of the change of DSD at a given point, and B square is the local variance, or if you like, B is the local standard deviation. So you have a very simple interpretation for the coefficient of DSD in Itô form. Expected value is the drift, in particular. It's good probabilistically in many respects. The big problem of Itô calculus is, as you well know, it does not satisfy the chain rule. So if you start from a differential equation like this and you change a variable with the function f, suppose it's smooth and everything, well, you have a second order term coming up in the change of variable, okay? The famous Itô formula, okay? So this ruins the chain rule, and in particular, when you change coordinates in a manifold, you change chart, the change of coordinates will have a second order term. So if this F is a transition map between two charts in a manifold, this is no longer the chain rule. So this kind of ruins the covariant nature of, you know, the quantities you're looking at. Okay? So the other integral, Fisk, Stratonovich, McShane, in finance you need the three names for every model, Igero, Morton, Coxinger, Soros, no, so I'm trying to adequate it here, Fisk, Stratonovich, McShane, it's an integral that satisfies the chain rule. So when you differentiate a function of x, you get the classic chain rule without any additional term. And so this is very good for geometry because you can use it in a covariant way, okay, when you change coordinates. And that's the reason of its success mostly. If not for this, I think and the second thing I'm going to say, probably this wouldn't be as well known. It's rarely used in finance though, so I said in the beginning. You know, people doing SDEs in finance will hardly have used the symmetric integral in general. So, okay, sorry, pushed the wrong button here. Let's go back. Now, the other thing that the Stratonovich integral has, which is very interesting, if you take stochastic differential equations and now replace the Brownian noise, which has unbounded variation, with smooth paths, let's say C1 processes, that converge to Brownian motion with probability 1 and uniformly on bounded time interval, Wong and Zakai way back showed that the solution to this stochastic differential equation with smooth noise converges not to the Itô solution, but to the Stratonovich one, okay? So if you're an engineer, you like this, because you say, okay, approximate my right noise or Brownian motion with some smooth noise, and in the limit, I will get an equation. But it's not the Itô one, it's the Stratonovich one, okay? So engineers occasionally do prefer this, for this property, prefer this. So summing up, Itô is good probabilistically, Stratonovich is good geometrically. I will try now to combine the two things and make Itô good geometrically, okay? There's several reasons. Before going into the reason, I have to explain why you can't solve this simply with the Itô-Stratonovich transformation, which is what I'm going to address next. So first, some historical notes. I have to say the Itô integral I find dominates among mathematicians. The Stratonovich integral, as I said, has managed to get noticed mostly for geometry, but otherwise it would hardly be used. And even mathematicians claim that under the formalism, it's Itô calculus which does all the work. You know, you find this in the Rogers and Williams famous book. So Stratonovich fared better with physicists. You know, if you look at Van Kampen's Itô versus Stratonovich paper, he argues that if a Langevin equation and the F term, the drift, let's say, is established by physics in somehow, and you want to add external random noise, then because of the Wong-Zakai result, if the noise converges to white noise in the limit, you want to use the Stratonovich version. But this is only true because the drift is fixed and has a physical reality. If the drift is not fixed, like in the case of internal noise, and you cannot really split the signal into drift and diffusion on physical basis, then both calculi can be used, and there is no reason to prefer it or Stratonovich beforehand. Now, let me give you a bit of history of the symmetric integral, because it's a bit interesting also regarding the mathematics community, okay? Now, the first to devise it apparently was Donald Fisk, who put it in his PhD thesis. He sent it, sent a number of results to the annals of probability, but this was considered to be trivial somehow, or not of interest. So they rejected the paper, okay? The annals. That was one of the big mistakes of the annals. And then in 1966, the symmetric integral comes out again in the book by Stratonovich in Russian. And then Skorohod, in the year, 1 year later, 67, reviews the book by Stratonovich. The second part could have been shortened by one half if the author had used, instead of his own integral, the Ito integral. Okay, this poor symmetric integral has no hope, okay? Searching out the drops of truth from this material is a thankless task which only the rare reader would undertake. So, I don't think Skorohod was very much interested in the chain rule. He was more interested in a chainsaw, you know? I mean, he just demolished, basically, the poor Stratonovich with this review. Okay. So, there is a way, however, this may look to you, if you know about the Ito-Stratonovich transformation, you may say, well, what is all this fuss? You know, you can always transform a stochastic differential equation in Ito form into a stochastic differential equation in Stratonovich form, which has the same solution under sufficient regularity on the coefficients. And to do this, you have to change the drift. And you have to change the drift by a term which depends on the partial derivative of the diffusion coefficient, like this. So if you shifted the drift of this quantity related to B, the diffusion coefficient, then the second equation is the first solution of the first, as the same solution as the first. So there seems to be no point in wondering about Ito calculus in geometry. Why don't you just do this? Take the initial SD in Ito form, transform it in Stratonovich form. The solution is the same. Work with geometry as much as you like with the Stratonovich version. And then, once you have the final approximation result or whatever, convert it back to Ito. That's it. What's the problem with this approach? Well, the problem is that the Ito-Stratonovich transformation does not commute with some geometry-based methods of approximation. For example, in a linear filtering, there is the assumed density filters that close the equation for the moment, infinite dimensional equation of the moments of the optimal filter, by assuming that the density on the right-hand side of the evolution equation is in a given exponential family, or even Gaussian, if it's the Gaussian assumed density filter. This closing assumption and the Ito-Stratonovich transformation do not commute. So in this case, an Ito-based, geometry would give you a different filter and a better one. But this is another paper, so I'm not going to talk about this in detail today, but I want to give it to you as a motivation. So more generally, you find that in stochastic PDE approximations, there can be a difference in applying the geometry directly to Ito or to Stratonovich transformed equations. For dimensionality reduction and approximation, these two procedures can give you different results. So it's worth really investigating the geometry of Ito equations directly. Okay, so then, how do we introduce a geometry in the Ito calculus? Well, this is done through the notion of jets. So what are jets for people who are not familiar with jets? Well, not these, okay? So I'm going to talk about, I want to introduce them slowly for people who are not familiar with the jet bundle and so on to explain what they are geometrically. So let's start with an example. Consider, first of all, in general, we'll work with a curve, a family of curves, gamma, centered at every possible point in Rn. We start with the Euclidean space. A curve is a function from the real numbers to the Euclidean space, and at the point at the time zero, let's say, the value of the curve is equal x, or the parameter zero, actually. So the curve is centered in the point we're interested in. So one example is this curve gamma E, which has the point itself, which is in coordinates, plus a circular counterclockwise component given by minus x1, x1, which is orthogonal to x1, x2, and goes with t. And then you have a radial quadratic in the parameter component going outwards. Okay, so this is an example of a curve, a second order curve in the parameter. But we'll see more general cases. If you plot these curves in all the possible points of the plane, we are in R2 in this example, you can draw the curves in an interval minus epsilon epsilon here, centered in zero, where the point is at the center. And you get this kind of picture, okay? So instead of a field of vectors, you have a field of curves, quadratic curves in this case. Now, you can define a stochastic differential equation like a scheme, a numerical scheme similar to those in Claudel and Platen, but we're going to do it now in a coordinate-free manner. We say that we start from x0, and at time t plus delta t, you just follow the curve, the quadratic curve in our example, along a variation of a parameter that is given by the increment of Brownian motion, okay? There is nothing coordinate dependent in this definition. I simply need to follow a curve. The curve can be in any space. This is given as a general algorithm. It can be a curve on a manifold. It can be a curve on a very different type of spaces. So in this case, you iterate the scheme, and then you go step by step, and you get something like this in the plane. Okay, start from 1, 0. And then you zigzag, and you get a typical two-dimensional coordinate-free SDE based on this specific curve, okay? Now, you can look at the convergence as you take the time step smaller and smaller, and you see this large time step smaller and smaller. So this is 2 minus 5.0, 0.2, minus 7, minus 9, and minus 11. And as you see, as you shrink the time step, the signal stabilizes to a limit, which we are going to prove rigorously in a minute, but intuitively you can see it already from the simulation. So this scheme then, where this is the increment of Brownian motion in tt plus dt, reads, follow the curve gamma starting from x for a parameter increment of dwt. So we're not using really the Rn vector space structure in this algorithm. I just follow the curve, whatever it is. So these discrete time steps will converge in some sense to a limit as the time steps tends to zero. We have seen that in the picture, but we have to make this precise, okay? And we will denote the limit by this notation. Xt follows the curve, gamma, starting from every local point, following the parameters increment given by Brownian motion, which is a continuous limit of the discrete time scheme. So how can the scheme limit be made precise now? Because I haven't really shown how this converges rigorously. And how does it relate to classic Itô calculus, okay? Because I haven't covered that yet. So the point, this is addressed via the notion of jets. To get there, you need to fix now a coordinate system. Because if you want to do a Taylor expansion, you need coordinates. This does use the vector space structure. So we use a coordinate system where the curve has a coordinate expression, and we express it with a Taylor expansion, order zero, first order, and second order term, plus a reminder term for the third order term, with a reminder in the Lagrange form, typically, okay? This is a classic Taylor expansion for curves with one parameter in Rn. Nothing fancy here. So the Taylor expansion for this scheme, then, can be applied to the SDE in coordinates. And if you write the scheme in coordinates, you get that the change in x is equal to the first order term here, plus the second order term of the Taylor expansion, the square here, this one, and then the remainder computed again in the parameter movement. Now, properties of Brownian motion, like the quadratic covariation, which I write here in a very friendly way, it should be written more properly, but just to shorten the story, dw squared is dt, and dw cubed, the cubic variation, if you like, is zero, okay? It's a well-known property of Brownian motion. So all you have to do is plug this inside here, and you get the following scheme, intuitively. Then you have to prove, of course, that it converges and everything. But you get this, if you can ignore this third order term in the limit, and you can replace in the limit this one with the t, what do you get here? This is the Euler scheme, okay? This is the Euler scheme. If you call b the first derivative of the curve in zero, and a the one half the second derivative of the curve in zero. So, with A and B defined that way, you get an Euler scheme driven by the functions A and B, which we know under suitable assumption, Lipschitz continuity or in X or other things, converges to the classical solution of the Ito stochastic differential equation with the same coefficients. So here we are one of the authorities on this kind of subjects, the benchmark book in convergence of numerical methods of OSD. So, we can see that, you know, in a given coordinate system, if you assume that the curve is smoothly varying in X with first and second t derivatives at zero that satisfy a Lipschitz condition in X, and if we assume that the third derivative is uniformly bounded in X, but you could relax some of these assumptions, especially this one, then you have this theorem. The following three schemes, they all converge to the Ito solution of the stochastic differential equation here. So one is the full scheme with a curve, which is coordinate free. The second one is the two-jet scheme, where you use the second order Taylor expansion, with the square here in particular, to replace the full curve. So you replace the full curve with the second order Taylor expansion, which, as I'm going to say in a second, is a two-jet. Okay? And then you have the classic Euler scheme that you have by replacing the W square with the T and keeping everything else the same. So you can show in L2 of P, in mean square, that these three schemes converge in a given coordinate system, but this is coordinate free actually, to the given classic Ito-stochastic differential equation in coordinates, okay, in the same coordinate system. So in our example, when you use this as a driver for the Brownian motion, the SDE would become something like this. You have the tree here, and the Brownian shock squared is dt, and then you have the orthogonal part in the Brownian shock itself here. So it's funny because the second order term now is the drift, okay? That's one of the things the jet does. So then we use the Taylor expansion in a given coordinate system, and its limit is, in a way, we have to explain in which sense the limit is coordinate free, because the Taylor expansion depends on the set of coordinates. So one way out would be to say immediately, well, we proved that the limit is the same as the full curved scheme, which is manifestly coordinate free, so it must be coordinate free. Well, that's an easy way to do it. The other way to do it is also to invoke the notion of jets. So we say that two smooth curves with one parameter, but this can be generalized to d parameters, which I'll do later, from R to Rn, have the same k jet if their Taylor expansion are equal up to order t to the k power, okay? In a given and all, hence all, coordinate systems, if you use smooth transition maps to connect the different charts. So the K-jet can be defined, for example, as an equivalent class of curves that share the first K terms in the Taylor expansion, similarly to how two tangent vector, the tangent vector can be defined as an equivalent class of all the curves that share the first derivative, basically. But you can go farther. With the jet, you go to a higher order term. You know, this has been introduced by Heresman in way back, Bourbaki, you know, we'll see a picture of Heresman at the end. I save it for the end. So basically, we say that the the coefficients of the classic stochastic differential equation in the Itô form are determined by the two jet of a curve in a specific coordinate system, but this transforms nicely because the jet is a coordinate-free notion. So jets are a much more general notion than what I'm doing here. You know, they're using a manifold, not just in Rn, and they are a sort of abstract Taylor expansions that are very useful in solving differential equations on manifolds. And there's notions, related notions are obstructions and symbol, which are very important. The symbol in particular is the Higher order term of the jet, where you're basically stopping the expansion. So we can say that in our earlier picture, one should avoid interpreting the whole curve beyond the first two terms, okay? So in another way, we're doing a field of second-order curves, or parabolas, if you like, in quadratic curves more generally, rather than vectors, which you do in a vector field representation. If the differential equation has a smooth driver, then you have vectors, basically, okay? In every point. Here, you have second-order curves in Itô calculus, okay? Which again confirms that it's a second-order calculus, but the second order is now interpreted in this geometric setting of the jets. So, the notation for a jet, the coordinate-free notation is J2, the second-order jet of the curve gamma, is denoted like this. So, we can write now the limit, rather than the full gamma, we use the jet notation to write the coordinate-free two-jet solution of the SD like that. So the theory extends straightforwardly using the charts to the manifold. So it doesn't have to be Rm, it can be just any n-dimensional manifold, actually. Infinite dimensional is another matter, okay? We've been using it in the stochastic filtering application, but there the math gets really heavier. Now, this allows also for a very nice interpretation of Itô's formula. So, if F is a smooth mapping from Rn to itself, and X satisfies our discrete time scheme we have seen earlier, F of X will satisfy the scheme F composed with the curve, you know, on the space. Then if you take the limit, you may guess that if you start from this coordinate-free SDE, equivalent in coordinates to the Itô SDE, the transformed equation is simply the jet of the composition of F with the curve. So Itô's formula in this case becomes very simple. It says that the transformation rule for jets under a change of coordinates is given by the composition of function. Itô's formula equals composition of functions in jet language. It's a very compact way of describing the Itô's formula. You can do the calculation in coordinates and confirm that it works well. This is kind of obvious. So, in a way, we have shown a way to draw an SD on a rubber sheet such that if the sheet is stretched, you know, the diagram transforms as per Itô's lemma. In a way. Or in another way of saying, this diagram is commutative. Get an SDE from X, draw it, get the picture of the SDE in Rn, apply a function f, and you get the f of the picture. But this is the same as using Itô's lemma to get directly the SDE for f of X and draw that. And I have a numerical example showing it with vector graphics versus, you know, simple manipulation software. This is the same example we had before, and we take this transform like a sort of polar coordinate, the arctangent and the log of the radius. And if you do that, this transforms into this equation in the new coordinates, which is much simpler, actually. And you can either transform this diagram mapping point by point with F, both the grid and the trajectory, or you can implement directly this new coordinates diagram by simulating this, the jet scheme for this SD. And you can see clearly that the two give the same result. This is based on simply mapping the points with the transformation. And this is writing the SD for the new coordinates, rather, simulating the SD for the new coordinates. And they give you the same signal. There's some small differences which are due to the numerical methods, but this example illustrates our commutative diagram in action, okay? Okay, so I will skip this. I don't want to make it too long. So this can be extended, as I said earlier, to SDEs not driven by a single Brownian motion, but by multidimensional Brownian motion, D Brownian motions in this example. And the limiting behavior will also depend only on the two jet, which is now, however, more general. We have to do a Taylor expansion in RD for a function defined on RD in Rn rather than with a single parameter, which brings about mixed derivatives and makes the things more interesting. In a way, if you look at the classical Ito SD in Rn with the d-dimensional Brownian motion, which I write it like this, okay, this corresponds to a drift and diffusion coefficient, which will be related, to the general curve by this kind of relationship. Now, Ra will be a diffusion matrix, will be a drift, associated to the second order term of the jet, and B will be the diffusion coefficient associated to the first derivative of the curve. So the two-dimensional jet, the two jet will be characterized in this case by more coefficients because the Taylor expansion is longer. If we write the SD in coordinates using the Einstein summation convention, so when you repeat indices down and up, a sum is occurring, then you can write the stochastic differential equation for Xi in this way, where this is a Kronecker delta if you use orthogonal coordinates, orthonormal actually coordinates, or more generally, if you don't, you have to put a two form defining the Euclidean metric in the specific space where you are. But otherwise, this is just Kronecker delta, and this is basically the two coefficients of the equation correspond to the multidimensional two jet. And you can also interpret the backward diffusion operator that comes up in Feynman-Katz and so on as related to the jet curve. So it's the one half the Laplacian, basically, of the composition of F, the test function, with the curve to which the jet is, or the SD is associated, basically. And you can define the adjoint, the one in the Kolmogorov-Fokker-Planck equation, similarly in a coordinate-free way. Now, there is a notion also of weak equivalence and strong equivalence of the SDEs with a d-dimensional Brownian driver in this context, because as you have seen here, the jet only uses part of the the SDE only uses part of the information on the jet, the diagonal terms only here, okay, because this is the Kronecker delta, and so you don't really use all the information on the jet, which means that you have to understand which parts of the jets are relevant for the SD in the multidimensional Brownian case, driving Brownian noise case. And we say the two jets are weakly equivalent if the diffusion operators associated with both curves that generate the jet, the two different jets, are the same, okay? Which means that only the sum on the diagonal terms, you remember in Ito's formula there is a trace term in Rn, so this basically corresponds to that. And we said that they are strongly equivalent if also the first term of the jet, which remember corresponds to the diffusion part, is the same. And these two notions correspond roughly, in case of pathwise uniqueness, to weak and strong solution, okay? In geometric terms. So strong equivalence in particular means that given the same realization of the multidimensional Brownian, the solution of the SDE will be almost surely the same under pathwise uniqueness assumptions. Weak equivalence refers more to the law of the, as coming from the multidimensional, the Fokker-Planck equation or Kolmogorov equation. So Let's go back a second to our example and give an example. So I have to put some finance here because I'm getting desperate now. It's everybody's going to shoot at me. So I have finally a slide with some finance, okay? We can cheer up. So this was the original example. And remember, it was not finance, not here. It was driven by a one-dimensional Brownian motion. And I showed you in geometric terms what happens. I'm going to now discuss how do you draw, actually, a stochastic differential equation in R2, but driven by two-dimensional Brownian motion. So where the two jet is generally written, you know, as this term here, generating the equation. And it's clearly has two arguments now, because the driving Brownian motion is two-dimensional. So I will choose one way to draw it is to plot the image of an epsilon ball in T1, T2 space through this function, which will be typically an ellipsoid. And actually, this would allow you, given the geometry of the ellipsoid, to recover the coefficients A and B up to weak equivalence, okay? So this is really an representation that encodes the SDE to some extent. I'm going to show you a very special system where we map the epsilon ball in T1, T2 and show what happens when you apply it to this. So the model I'm choosing is the Eston model, okay? It's the stochastic volatility model. So you have a conditional on the volatility squared root of volatility of geometric Brownian motion, but actually the volatility follows, let's say, the squared volatility follows a mean square process, Coxinger-Soros type dynamics. They can be correlated, where I include it here explicitly. And I'm showing for these values of the parameters, in particular in balls, the map of balls of radius 5% in the plane. So these kind of ellipses encode the information of the jet and the displacement of the point, which is where the point SV in the plane SV, where we're centering each ball, the displacement from the center of the ellipses is the indication of the drift, for example. Whereas the distance from the border in the axis gives information on the diffusion coefficients. So another possibility is looking at to interpret the one-dimensional, in this case, SD. So one-dimensional Brownian, one-dimensional signal, is to look at fun diagrams of quantiles, if you like. Okay, we know that there are some notions in probability that are not coordinate-free. For the most important, for example, possibly is the expected value, you know. If you have a change of coordinate F, and you apply to a random variable, the expected value of f of x is not f of the expected value of x. So expectations are not covariant. They don't change nicely with coordinates. But the percentile is only related to the order in R. It's not depending on the specific set of the coordinates. It's not related to the vector space structure, only to the ordering. So as a result, you know, for example, for continuous monotonic f, you can say that the median of f of x is f applied to the median of x. So the median transforms with the coordinate change, unlike the mean. And the same holds for the percentile. If you take an increasing transformation, then, you know, the percentile transforms like f. So you can draw a Fran diagram. I understand this is used often in econometrics when you have this is the history of the path. Then today you take a confidence level around the current value and one sigma, for example, confidence level, and you can draw a Fran around any future trajectories which will stay inside this thing with a given confidence level. And you can use asymptotics of SDEs in dimension one to derive an expansion for small times of the solution of the SDE in the time-dependent non-autonomous case in this example. And here I won't spend much time on this because I really like to move to the last part. But the interesting thing, and there is a typo, this should be divided by two, is that actually the in the expansion, this is the Stratonovic drift. If you remember the Itô-Stratonovic transformation, and you take in this quantile, you take alpha corresponding to the median, then this goes away and you have a straight line corresponding to the Stratonovic drift of the SD. So the Itô drift we said earlier that corresponds to the expected, you know, trend of the SD. The expectation in the change of X is the drift valued in X. And interestingly, it looks like for small time, the drift in the Stratonovic SD corresponds to the median, at least in the one-dimensional case. Okay, I'll just skip the other part. So let's sum up what we have seen. We have seen that geometrically, a Stratonovic SD is described by two vector fields. So you have a drift and a diffusion coefficient in Stratonovic form. And because the Stratonovic equation satisfies the chain rule, these two behave like vector fields. They are nice geometrically. So you could represent geometrically a Stratonovic equation like a two-dimensional vector field, like two, sorry, vector fields, one for the drift, one for the diffusion. If you change coordinates, these will change with the chain rule. So they are indeed vector fields. However, we've seen that the Itô equation instead is can be represented as a single two-jet. So you have one side, you have two vector fields. On the other side, you have one two-jet. And now we want to see if there is any relationship geometrically between this Itô and Stratonovic representation so that maybe we can interpret geometrically the Itô-Stratonovic transformation that I introduced earlier. Well, there is a result that we prove in the paper. So suppose that you have K vector fields in the manifold or in the space where you are, basically. And you apply all the vector field one after the other. You apply the flow of all the vector field one after the other with a time t for the first vector field, a time t squared for the second vector field, and a time t to the power k for the kth vector field. Then this gives you a curve in particular. Okay, starting from x, you apply all these vector field flows, one after the other, you compose them, and this gives you an evolution, a curve. And we call a vector field, this also defines a k-jet, clearly, because you go up to term k, a specific one. And we can call this basically a specific vector field representation of a k-jet. The question is, are all k-jets representable? Can be all of them represented like this? And the answer is yes. We have a theorem in the paper, which is probably known in geometry, but we prove it for this specific context. All k-jets of curves can be obtained as composition of vector field flows with increasing powers in T. So, as a consequence, in the two-jet case in specifically, you can use now the fact that the two-jet curve can be represented as a composition of two vector fields to interpret the Itô-Stratonovic transformation. The two-jet is Itô. The two vector fields you apply are Stratonovic. And the relationship, if you write it in a coordinate chart explicitly, it's done here with the x, t square and t, this gives you that if gamma is coming from here, the coefficients of the jet representation are related to the coefficients of the vector field through these formulas. And indeed, you see, this is the Itô-Stratonovic drift relationship with the partial derivative of the diffusion coefficient and the diffusion coefficient itself. So the Itô-Stratonovic transformation corresponds to alternative representation of two jets as a subsequent application of vector fields or directly in the Itô case as a two jet. So we have a new interpretation then for the Itô-Stratonovic transformation. I mean, it's interesting because some review of stochastic geometry argue that you cannot really do stochastic geometry without Stratonovich calculus, which is actually not true. There is a paper in 1950 by Ito in the Nagoya journal where he uses simply Ito's formula as a change of coordinate and redefines, you know, the equivalence classes and everything so as to have stochastic calculus on manifolds. It's not very clear it's coordinate free because he uses the Ito formula to check for transition maps and so on, but it was done very early. So this is not true, and there are a lot of works by Emery and others that define the Ito bundle, second order tangent vectors, which however are not as nice geometrically as jets, so that's less clear, that's appealing. But it's not true that you nearly need to use Stratonovich calculus if you want to do geometry, as we have shown. You have this alternative representation that allows you to use Ito with the jets. Now, from an extrinsic differential geometry perspective, you know, when you look at embeddings and so on from a larger space, you may think that Stratonovich is necessary because if I give you a differential equation and you want to check if it's on a submanifold, you look whether the vector field is tangent to the submanifold, and then you know you stay there, roughly. With Stratonovich is easy, then. You check that the drift and the diffusion coefficient are both tangent to the submanifold, and you know it stays there. If you don't have, you know, this, what do you do? Well, however, in the jet approach, it's easy. You're just saying that the curvature of the two jets follows the curvature of the manifold. So instead of looking at the tangent vector, you go up to order two in the geometric sense, and you can still, and you can use directly Ito calculus, as the previous equivalence vector fields, the jets I showed illustrates. So, Ito or Stratonovich, what if I told you that it's just different coordinates, okay? It's like I give you a blue pill and a red pill, and maybe wake up in a world where there's only Ito calculus or in a world where it's only Stratonovich calculus. It doesn't matter. It's not like the matrix, really, you know? This is irrelevant. They are just different coordinate systems. But it's still important to choose because there are notions in probability starting from the expected value. So even very, very basic notions that they're not coordinate free. They don't change covariantly with the coordinate system. I'm done. No, I'm not done. Sorry, I'm done. I will say I have 1 minute to go. Sorry. No. So conclusions, give me 1 minute for the conclusions. Come on, so Stratonovich has these on manifold are two vector fields. And now my message is Ito SDEs are just one, two jet, okay? And the two things are equivalent. We have a new geometric jets-based interpretation of the SDEs coefficients, of the diffusion operator, of the Ito-Stratonovich transformation, percentiles, we're still working on that, actually, and other SDE concepts. There are, as I said, two coordinate systems, and you can choose the most convenient coordinate system depending on the problem you have. That's your guide, really. You know, if you care about convergence and one Zakai is important to you, then you would use Stratonovich. If you care about the martingale property and non-anticipative features, then you go for the Ito. So it really depends on the application. The most important difference, I think, arises in the modeling process, okay? It's when you choose the type of equation you really need to write down in the first place, then the choice is most telling. So it's not a purely computational thing. It requires the modeler intuition. So, you know, some guys wrote, the ultimate goal of mathematics is to eliminate the need of all need for intelligent thought. And this clearly shows it's not true, actually. Sorry, I wanted just to show you a bit of dramatis persona here. This is Kiyoshi Ito, Ruslan Stratonovich, Edward McShane. I didn't mention him a lot, but he did very interesting work on stochastic integration very early. Donald Fisk, I couldn't find the picture. This guy's really, you know, after these annals of probability thing, he just went for an industry career, I think. Wolfgang von Döblin seems to have a very interesting adventurous story during the war, sent a package with basically Itô's formula, it looks like. But this wasn't in during the Second World War, but it wasn't opened until a few years ago. And this is Charles Eresmann, who introduced the notion of jets with Bourbaki way back in the 50s in France. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Hard to ask questions on a talk like this.
Would there be like an equivalent in jets if you took a different point rather than a midpoint, initial point? I mean, so that's just Itô and Stratonovich, but you could take any.
There's McShane's belated integral. It's a good question. I haven't thought about it, actually. We could do a fully anticipative integral, maybe, or... No, I haven't looked at that. We had enough work with these two at the moment, but it's interesting. Yeah, I think we have a colleague who's joining our team who is an expert in stochastic integration, Pietro Surpais. So I think I will want to talk to him about this once he arrives. But yeah, I don't know at the moment.
Any other questions? No, so let's thank all the speakers of today.
Yeah.